a meal every day. The jungle of obstacles is still in my way. Before I brush my teeth, I kneel and I pray. At this foundation, I'm building a state. It get cold where I'm from. The chill doesn't play. 10 toes down, nigga, with this.
The other day, Drake called me a legend. And it was kinda hard to say thanks, cause at the time I had less than $20 in the bank. The same time I had about a quarter in the tank, and that was of the Uber. But here I am surrounded by all these shakers and movers, hobnobbers and schmoozers, pill heads, boozers, occasional coke tutors. Who's to say that the way that the Lord used you will always be conducive to your future? You don't make the plans. When you a hostage, you don't make demands. You do your job, kiss the babies and shake the hands. I'm a true politician, picking up the scrap metal and welding a new pot to pissin. I've been destined to ball since Trapuca was a piston. Make a difference to any of the few that would listen. You are now in tune to the mission. You gotta change your bait when you fishing. Listen.
Yo, what up? It's the incredible Marv Won, wonderful, world famous fat fucking killer. Rocking with Theorematic. Check out my interview. I'm fire. Talking that shit.
Before I brush my teeth, I kneel and I pray. That this foundation, I'm building a state. It get cold where I'm from. The chill doesn't play. 10 toes down, nigga.
I first started taking it serious when I started skipping school to go to the studio. So maybe when I was like 15, 16. Making very shitty decisions was the next step. Skipping school, not doing work, not going to school at all. Basically putting all my eggs in one basket, like, you know what I'm saying, barely graduating because of it. But my love for it was so strong, and I felt like it was my calling. I felt like it was what I was put here to do, that nothing else mattered. But the next thing was trying to get your name known. So wherever somebody was rapping, I was there. You know, trying to be heard, or trying to battle, or, you know, just having someone recognize me was that was next.
I'm just trying to get through the night, asking God to show me where I went wrong in my life. Sleeping in a jacket, I felt like a piece of ice.
My generation, it was never about being the best battle rapper. It was always, I'm battling with an ulterior motive. You know what I'm saying? I want I want to use this as promotion. So me living in both worlds, like, that's what I've always done. The music has always been the primary focus. It was just that the battle world became so big, and the gratification became so instant, that it was like, okay, well, I can do this to set aside shit for this. You know what I'm saying? I feel like you have to be a good rapper in order, or you had to be a good rapper in order to be a good battle rapper. You don't have to nowadays. Like, you can look on YouTube and fucking learn how to battle rap. Like, you can paint by numbers as opposed to being a rapper who's stepping into the world. But if you put a lot of battle rappers in a booth on the beat, they sound absolutely trash because they're not real rappers. That's the downside.
To all the ladies in the place with style and grace and stretch marks on your waist, stuffing food in your face, put your hands up. Be proud of what you're doing.
I was actually in a collective of MCs called The Characteristics. It was me, it was Disaster, it was my man Speck from Black Lagoon, it was my man Samaj, it was I was in a collective of people who taught me the basics of rap. So when I went to the Lush and saw the next level, I was like, oh, this is where not just me, but where my whole crew needs to be for us to get better. You know what I'm saying? So, but no, I wasn't. It just so happens that my man Cobb, RIP, he was the lead producer of the Teamsters. Teamsters were huge around the city. A rap group. They were super big. Like, the promotion was everywhere. Fucking, like, the picket signs and all that shit. They was fire. And his little man was Fat Father. And Fat Father is a year older than me, but he's like rhyme-wise, he's fucking incredible. Always been. Probably the most underrated MC here, like, without question. So, you know what I'm saying? We got cool. We were both, you know what I'm saying, fat. We were both charismatic. You know what I'm saying? We both could rap. and being as how we were so close in age, we took a liking to each other. That was my man. And we were standing outside the Lush one night, and Fat was like, "Man, you know what? You know, we both fat. We both killers on the mic. We should just be the Fat Killers." And it started out as a joke. And we, you know what I'm saying, we told Gordy, and eventually we told Bango, and we did our first song. It was a song called Fat World that Cobb did. And we looked around and was like, "Oh shit, this is a lot easier than writing three verses." You know what I'm saying? So we pushed it on through like that. Like when people saw the click up, they was like, "Oh shit, this is gonna be great." And like, it was instant. It was instant. It was infectious. People loved us from jump. Probably a little bit too much. We probably saw a little bit too much too soon, honestly. Not like in hindsight, because we didn't lose like for like 3 years. Like, we didn't lose. Like, we didn't. There wasn't anything that we said that we weren't going. There wasn't anything that we said we were going to do that we didn't do. From tours to meetings to offers, like, there was nothing that we didn't do.
So, like, what? So you said in hindsight. So what do you see that kind of did it? How did it affect you?
Because we didn't know how to take a loss. So when we took our first loss, in my opinion, you know what I'm saying, we buckled under that pressure because we were so used to fucking winning. You know what I'm saying? It's like we were literally like the 72-10 Bulls. It was like when we got an L, it was like, "What, we lost? Hell no." And then we just ran 50 off again. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, we like in hindsight, like we didn't know how to bounce back from a loss. So I think that stopped a lot of our momentum. You know what I'm saying?
I do it for my niggas. The saints, the shooters and the killers, the movers and the dealers. I make music for gorillas.
I did get to the point of comfort with that. But it was very recently. It was recently, you know what I'm saying? I felt, of course, when you come in, you have these big, huge, fucking grandiose dreams of like, "Yo, I'm gonna be Jay-Z. Jay-Z's the pinnacle." You know what I'm saying? For us, it was like, "Yo, I'm gonna be Jay-Z. I'm clothing, alcohol, the pretty R&B girl." And when it doesn't happen and you're left holding the bag, or if it doesn't happen and you're left holding the bag, you may not know how to survive. So for me, my definition of success changed. My definition of success became, if I'm able to, because you know, in Detroit, the fucking, what everybody doing is working at the factory. Everybody working at the plant. Everybody working at Ford or GM or Chrysler. So my thing was, if I'm able to make just as much as somebody who works there off doing what I want to do, that's success for me. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's not the ceiling. It's not how far I feel I can go or how far I want to go, but that success for me. Still being my own boss, still doing what I want to do on my own terms, on my own hours.
The only thing scarier than a cell is the cop that can put you in it. And if they having a bad day, you better do what the bad say, because it seems like they sniping us every minute.
Yeah, man, I was excited. I was excited. I was real happy with the response. I think it was the first time, it was the first project that I went into knowing exactly what I was going to give somebody. It wasn't somebody else's direction. It wasn't, you know what I'm saying, like I knew what I wanted to present. It took me a long time to get there as an artist. It took me a long time. But it was just like, hey, you know what? I've been around so many great minds that I see them put it together. I've seen the Nine put projects together. I watched Royce put projects together. And it's like, you know what I'm saying? Oh, I can do this. So it was just me. Like, I didn't want the regular trappings of a fucking rap album. I didn't care about the big single. I didn't care about the R&B hook. Like, I just wanted to fucking rap. I didn't want any bells. I didn't want any whistles. And I wanted to be transparent. I wanted to be very honest. I wanted the person who may not have $1,000 to spend in the fucking club, who may not have, you know what I'm saying, hundreds of dollars to blow on a bottle at the titty bar, I wanted you to put this album in and be like, yo, I fuck with it.
I did.
I felt that I finally made the music that I listened to. I listened to Kai. We were talking about Kai. I listened to Rock Marsh. I listened to Conway. I listened to Gunn. You just put me up on Willie the Kid for real, for real. You know what I'm saying? Like, I listened to Quelle Chris and Denmark Vesey. Like, I finally made the music that I listened to. You know what I'm saying? It was super organic. Like, it was like, it wasn't any doubt in my mind. Like, if people didn't fuck with it, I wouldn't have cared. It was just like, yo, for the people that get it, they get it. For the ones that don't, I'm not mad at you. You're not supposed to. That's how I felt going into the album.
I've been in it for a minute, couple dealings in the game. I know it's love there, but the feeling ain't the same. It's a shame, shit. I went from living in a dream.
It was a gift and a curse when people found out that I, you know what I'm saying? Like, I knew it was going to be a selling point. But I was also very apprehensive. Like, you know, what if people don't fuck with this shit? You know what I'm saying? Like, it was always just a little hustle. Like, every now and again, you know what I'm saying? People be like, oh, you make beats? Like, I dabble. But I feel that it adds longevity. Like, I don't necessarily have to ask anybody for anything. You know what I'm saying? I'm not on anybody's time clock. I'm not waiting for anyone to... I'm not waiting on anybody to deem me worthy of their time. So, you know, I've always known how to produce. Like I said, I've been around the best producers ever. I've been around Denial Porter. I've been around Silent Riot. I've been around whoever you can think of. And you'd be a fool if you don't take something from those people. You know what I'm saying? If you don't learn how to do something. So, you know, I locked myself in a room and learned. I got a machine and learned how to use it. You know what I'm saying? I was an MP guy, but you know, the MP got too big and bulky. Couldn't fucking carry that around. And like, I learned how to use it. And now, you know what I'm saying? I feel that I've added years to my career because of it. You know what I'm saying? I can give you a sound. I have people coming to me now. Like, I'm producing whole projects for people. You know what I'm saying? It hurt mine. I was like, oh shit. I would like, you know, I like the cohesiveness of it. I like how it flows, or I like, you know what I'm saying, how everything makes sense. Can you do that for me?
Time that I've invested, and this is all I know. I gotta see what this shit got for me. I know that there's a better chance of me hitting a lottery, so I'm putting my numbers
in. You can expect a person who loves rapping to rap his ass off. That's it. Like, I'm not necessarily, like, I can't necessarily tell you about what's happening in the club. I can't tell you about, you know what I'm saying, what's popping in Saint-Tropez, or, you know what I'm saying, I've never met Poppy, I've never sold a brick of cocaine, but if you want a nigga who can rap, you know, say some shit and say it slip, and make you fuck with it, that's me, until the end of time. Even if you don't fuck with it, I'ma do it, you know what I'm saying, because I'm good at it. Like, that's it. Like, I'm a nigga that can rap his ass off. Who's going to continue to rap his ass off until God calls him home.
A couple of weeks ago, yeah, M called me dope. So why the fuck am I broke? No kids and I don't smoke. Starting to feel like God is the best screenwriter and I am the punchline to one of his biggest jokes. I guess it's egg on my face that makes it so difficult to keep your head in the race and stay ahead of the pace that you set at regular rates. My life is a movie, I'm trying to edit the tapes. You know how much bread it'll take? Stacks upon stacks, I'm like a new dry cleaners. I need racks upon racks. I'm the truth with the paper, nigga, that's facts upon facts. Keep your eyes on your cheese, cause rats is gon' rat. Don't ask about traps, cause you gon' get an answer you ain't looking for. Why you over the stove if you ain't cooking, though? We worry about going up, we don't look below. You searching for your chance, we done took it, bro.